Very good evening, everyone, and welcome to live discussion on latest AAR ruling in case of MasterCard Asia Pacific Pte. Limited. And two gentlemen sitting on my left hand side are Shri Kamlesh Varshney and Ashish Karundia, who is the chartered accountant. Kamlesh Varshney is Commissioner Income Tax of International Taxation, and he is the one who argued the case successfully in front of AAR. And Ashish has authored a book on permanent establishment, and this case is primarily relates to permanent establishment issue in case of MasterCard. So the purpose of holding this live discussion is more from the perspective of education, that we can share knowledge on permanent establishment issues or on the case law with the audience at large. I trust that this discussion is going to be useful for everyone, and I'm thankful to Kamlesh ji for sparing time and coming out and ready to share his knowledge about the case and about the subject. And I'm also thankful to Ashish, who made this possible, who conceptualized this, that Gaurav, we should have a discussion like this for the benefit of everyone. Thanks to both of you being here. So now, from where we should start? This is a very big judgment of almost 123 pages, and it captures a lot of fact. So the issue was primarily on permanent establishment, and the foreign entity, that is the appellant MasterCard Asia Pacific Pte. Limited, was getting some fee from Indian entity, and their contention was that they do not have permanent establishment in India, neither it is a fee for technical services or royalty, and accordingly there should not be any withholding of tax in India, or this income is not chargeable to tax in India, correct?
Yes.
Whereas the department argued that the MasterCard has got permanent establishment in India, and it also forms, or this transaction also qualifies as FTS or royalty, and accordingly withholding should be there. So, sir, if you can briefly let us know about the fact, what happened in this case, what is the flow, because it is very complicated, and unless the viewers are clear on the facts, they would not be able to appreciate the argument behind those facts.
Yeah. So, thank you, Gaurav. So, basically, let me start on facts. So, what happens that these are the cards. It could be credit card or it could be debit card, which are used by the customers in India. So now this card will have, like, this is a SBI card, and then it will have MasterCard logo here. So what happens is, that means this card is issued by SBI, and so that is, SBI is called issuer bank. So I have an account with SBI, I go to SBI, SBI issue me a card, so I am the customer. SBI in this particular case is an issuer bank. Now I go to a merchant and I buy some products, some goods. So when I swipe my card, the merchant POS is linked with his bank, because merchant will have an account with bank. That may not be SBI, it may be some other bank. So that is called acquire bank. So acquire bank, that information will go to acquire bank, and then from acquire bank, the information will go to the issuer bank, which is SBI in this case. And once issuer bank says that yes, this card belongs to Kamlesh Varshney and he has sufficient money in his bank account, so the transaction gets through, or he has a credit limit of that particular amount, so the transaction happens. So all this transaction goes through a multiple set of equipment and wires, cables, etc. I will explain you how that happens. But the issue here is that both issuer bank and acquirer bank have a kind of a small computer type instrument at their premises, which is called MasterCard Interface Processor. Because this is MasterCard, it is called MasterCard Interface Processor. We will call it MIP. Similarly, for Visa also, there is similar kind of instrument which also has an acronym associated with it. But RuPay does not have this kind of instrument like MIP and this whatever Visas have. So RuPay, in the case of RuPay, which is our Indian card, the information goes directly between acquirer bank and issuer bank. But in case of MasterCard and Visa, it goes through these instrument. So what the applicant is saying that we do not have any permanent establishment in India. We have a server in Singapore. So when a customer undertakes a transaction with a merchant bank and merchant bank sends the information to the MIP of the acquirer bank, then MIP of the acquirer bank has a software inside which encrypts the data, and that encrypted data goes to a server in Singapore, and then from that Singapore the processing activity takes place, and from Singapore it goes to the MIP of the issuer bank, and once it goes to the MIP of the issuer bank, then issuer bank finally says yes, it authorizes the transaction. So this is authorization of transaction. This is how it happens. So there are three parts to transaction processing. First is authorization, which I just explained. Then there is clearance, and then there is settlement. Because all this has happened, if this transaction has happened, then let us assume that the acquirer bank is ICICI in this case, and issuer bank is SBI in this case. So ICICI bank has assured the merchant with whom I have undertaken the transaction, suppose it is on credit, that okay, don't worry, you can sell your goods to Mr. Kamlesh Varshney, you will get your money back. So that means this acquirer bank has a right to receive money from the issuer bank. That is ultimately it from my account, that money will go to the acquirer bank, and then acquirer bank will pay the money to the merchant. So this is in all these transactions, of course, there is some fixed amount that they are supposed to retain and pass it on to the MasterCard in Singapore. So that Singapore MasterCard entity in Singapore receives this money from these banks. But this is one transaction is very simple, you know, that SBI bank has to give 100 rupees to I have undertaken 100 rupees of transaction. So SBI has to give 100 rupees to ICICI bank, and then ICICI bank has to pay, let's say, 97 or 98, whichever is the amount, whatever is settled between them, to the merchant, and then from the this 2 or 3 rupees, it has to pay to MasterCard some amount as fees. So this is how authorization happened. But there are multiple transactions every day. So it is not that there is only one transaction between ICICI bank and the SBI bank. There are thousands of transactions, and there are hundreds of banks involved. So all this data is to be collated, and that collation happens. So once that data is collated, so at the end of the day, each day settlement takes place. So there are hundreds of transactions done by ICICI bank, hundreds of transactions done by SBI bank, and in one case there may be acquirer bank, in another case there may be issuer bank. So all this has to be added up, subtraction, everything, all that arithmetical calculation has to happen, and then at the end of the day it is finally determined that which bank is to be debited and which bank is to be credited. So this is a overall scenario which emerges at the end of the day. So every morning MasterCard Singapore sends that instruction to Bank of India. Bank of India is the authorized bank here in India, which does actually posting of debit and credit entry in the accounts of various banks. So that is settlement. So when Bank of India gets that instruction from MasterCard Singapore entity that A bank debit 10,000 rupees, B bank credit 1 lakh rupees, C bank debit 50,000 rupees, like these kind of instruction they get. So Bank of India every day carry out that instruction as per the instruction of MasterCard Singapore, and then accounts are settled. So this is all that activity which happens, three activity: authorization, clearance and settlement, which happens. And the claim of the MasterCard Singapore is that all that happens outside India, nothing happens in India. So therefore, there is no permanent establishment. So these are the brief facts which were presented by the applicant.
Okay. So, Ashish.
You were saying that one of the steps is authorization.
Right.
So is it that the entire leg of authorization happens outside India, or is it that a part of that transaction, like initial verification of the person who is swiping the card, that happens in India? How this authorization works?
Yeah, so see, now let us understand that functional delineation, that what functions are happening in India and what functions are happening outside India.
Yes.
That is very important to determine whether there is a permanent establishment or not. We will come to other parts of PE like disposal test later on.
Yes.
But first, let us see what functions are performed in India and what functions are performed outside India. So let us concentrate on authorization. So now, there is a very good description in the AAR order that who does what activity. So they're like, and when we try to do that, we need to keep out that what are the activities which are performed by third parties and what are the activities which are performed by the applicant or its subsidiary here in India. So that will be very helpful in determining whether the functions, significant functions, are happening in India. So when I go to the merchant with my credit card, so merchant does initial verification that, okay, Kamlesh Varshney looks at me, that, you know, he can't do much, but he just have to believe that, you know, unless he has a suspicion that I'm not Kamlesh Varshney, but otherwise he just has to accept and he just has to swipe the card in his POS. Then when that data travels to his bank, which is Acquire Bank MIP, and then from there, here, very important thing happened. According to the applicant, the way they submitted before AAR, it was they pleaded that it was the MIP is only doing encryption activity and a very low level of verification. So this is what they submitted before AAR. But revenue view was that MIP are doing preliminary validation and verification. So that is, and that was there from the application itself. You know, whenever taxpayer have to file an application before AAR, they have to give full description of facts. And in those facts, they had mentioned that MIPs carry out preliminary verification and validation, like PIN checking, address verification, names verification, and validation of card codes. So this is what they had written there in their application, which was filed before AAR. And then we had also produced the transfer pricing report of the Indian subsidiary, MISPL, and same facts were written in that transfer pricing report also. So these two evidences were produced before AAR that they are just not doing transmission of information, they are just not doing encryption, they are also doing these significant activities which are helpful in authorization. So when we speak about authorization, these are the significant activities. Of course, what is happening in Singapore is also significant, and that is what AAR has said. Yes, what is happening in Singapore is also significant, because what Singapore server is doing, that it is securing the whole transaction, it is doing fraud detection. They have an algorithm that they do fraud detection and all. This is what was produced before, submitted before AAR, and AAR on that basis said that yes, applicant is right, that Singapore is also doing a significant activity. But the question is, when we have to determine whether significant activities are happening in India or not for the purpose of permanent establishment, we need to see in the overall context what are the functions performed in India and whether those functions are significant. Now, in the case of when authorization happens, ultimate authorization is done by the issuer bank. Like in my examples, SBI card will do ultimate authorization that, okay, fine, it is correct card, it has a credit limit, it belongs to the correct person. So that final authorization is done by a third party. That's all right. But in between, what is done by MasterCard? So what is done by MasterCard is that it has a Singapore server in Singapore which secures the transaction, does fraud detection. Then it has a MIP in India, which does this preliminary verification. And it was also mentioned in the application as well as in the transfer pricing report that in case of an error, MIP alerts the bank. Now that is very important aspect, important facts relied upon by the AAR. That means MIP is doing a part of authorization activity. So when we look at the overall authorization activity. This is a very important role played by MIP. So one cannot say that because Singapore is doing significant activity, we don't have to look at India. In fact, all the PEs that are created in India, suppose I am selling certain things. Toyota is manufacturing car outside India, and it is selling car in India through a liaison office or something. So you will say liaison office is actually not doing proprietary and auxiliary work, because selling of a car is the main activity. So it will create a PE. Now Toyota cannot run around and say that my significant activities are happening in outside India, where I am using intangible, I am manufacturing car, everything. That's all right. That significant work is happening outside India. But what is important is that significant work is also happening in India. So similarly, server may be doing a significant work in Singapore in the case of MasterCard. But what MIP is also doing so far as authorization is concerned, that is also a significant work. And that is what was held by AAR.
So what we are arguing is whether that MIP in India will per se going to create a permanent establishment of MasterCard Singapore in India or not. That's the argument which is going. That's why the role of MIP becomes important in the whole transaction.
Yes. One more thing, like you said that even though there are certain functions which are happening in Singapore which are significant, that doesn't cut down the importance of functions which are being undertaken in India. So under the age-old practice which we see in the, what I can say, Amar Bhai, all those kind of judgments, therein the transactions will generally be divided only in three parts, like procurement, manufacturing and sales. Now those four activities also, those kind of activities are also are further drilled down to see even in that significant activity in which country a part of that significant activity is being undertaken. So in nutshell, if there is a significant transaction which is being taken or significant function, that significant function can also be further drilled down. And if a part of that significant function is being undertaken in any other country, then that will also be triggering.
Yes, absolutely. Okay. Absolutely.
And in this case, being, you know, the three steps which we are talking, authorization, clearance and settlement, these are three main important functions.
Yes.
Because of which one has enrolled the MasterCard or Visa.
Yes.
From that perspective. So out of if these three functions, you know, substantial functions are performed in India, one can successfully argue that substantial activity is going on in India and Indian activity is going on through some person or through some equipment or through some place, one can say yes, that from this fixed place or from this place you are carrying out business, and accordingly permanent establishment should be there. That what the line of argument went into. Am I correct, sir?
Yeah, you are correct. So basically there were many, so when we talk about MIP, so functions are, I just discussed, there were other issues which were also discussed, that the MIPs are not owned by the applicant in Singapore. When I say applicant, that means Singapore entity. MIPs are not owned by Singapore entity. So the question was that is it important for permanent establishment that the place or the equipment which is creating a permanent establishment of a non-resident enterprise must be owned by it? In fact, a lot of judgments were quoted by revenue, that Formula 1 is a best example. Formula 1, in the case of Formula 1, the JP that where the race course was not owned by the non-resident enterprise, but still it was held to be the permanent establishment of non-resident enterprise. Even OECD commentary in Article 5 makes it very clear that ownership is not important. There are other tests which must be satisfied, but ownership is not important. Then the issue was whether automatic equipment can create permanent establishment, because MIP is an automatic instrument. You don't need human intervention to operate MIP. So that is also there in OECD commentary also, that automatic equipment can create permanent establishment. There are various server cases. Like if you see this Formula 1 case, Supreme Court quoted Swift server case. Then from Ashish book, Revenue had quoted ATO server case, French online video game, and then there was also other cases which were quoted to prove, Swedish data center case. So to prove that, you know, automatic equipment can create PE, and it is not necessary that it must be operated by a human being. So that was also a very important point which was discussed. So when we spoke about MIP, So these were the important points discussed, and then later on it came whether it was at a disposal or not, so we can discuss that. But yes, before we come to disposal test, it was required that, you know, whether MIP satisfy the other conditions, then it need not to be fixed on the ground. It is enough that it is placed on the table. So that is also very settled law, that when we say fixed as permanent establishment, it need not to be fixed to the ground. And even if it is placed at a particular place, it can create P. So those things are very important to understand for P.
Okay.
And permanency is not a problem, because it is placed for entire duration of the year. So permanency is not an issue here in this case.
So, sir, I have a couple of questions, not exactly on the facts of the case, but how the case went ahead.
Mm-hmm.
So the book which you are talking about, of Ashish on the permanent establishment for the benefit of everyone, this is the book, which was referred, and wherein you can find a lot of judgments on permanent establishment. I think fantastic book written by Ashish. So a lot of reliance has been placed on the foreign case laws by the department and also on the OECD. In addition to the transcribing document prepared by the entity, I think which went against the appellant. So if you can, in brief, tell us how being we are in India, we need to read the case laws of India or, the Act. What is the, sanctity of placing reliance on the foreign judgments or OECD?
Yeah, see, let's be very clear that OECD commentary, in my views, is an important tool, but it must be read with the observation of India or position of India in that OECD commentary. In fact, if you see OECD commentary, it has an introduction, and para 3 and para 30 of that introduction makes it very clear that OECD commentary is to be read along with the observation or the position taken by a particular country. So even revenue quoted from OECD commentary to support its case, but those were the paragraph or those were the notes of OECD commentary which are on which India does not have any position. So therefore, to that extent, OECD commentary can always be relied upon, and to that extent it should be relied upon, because it gives a kind of a certainty. Of course, there are some issues where even OECD countries have reservation on what OECD has said in their commentary, and their case laws in those countries, whether it is France or Spain, that they have said, yes, we need to interpret OECD commentary according to the observation my country has put there. So therefore, it is very important that we must understand this point, that yes, OECD commentary is an important tool, but we need to be careful that it is it has to be interpreted keeping the observation of a particular country in mind. And so far as foreign tax laws are concerned, yes, there could be variation in domestic laws of those countries. So whenever domestic law is important and we are relying upon domestic law, then probably we need to be careful. If it is an international tax law that we are, or tax treaty that we are interpreting, it could be a very helpful tool. In fact, Formula 1 Supreme Court relied on Swedish server case and quoted the Swedish server case to demonstrate and relied upon that case. And so in my view, foreign tax laws can be relied upon in order to argue a particular point of view.
Okay, I will come back on the transparency document. Actually, you were having some questions.
Yeah, sir, like you explained, what we understand for a fixed, for a permanent establishment, there are certain attributes which are required. Like there has to be a place of business, and that place of business has to be fixed. By fixed, it means it has to be geographically and commercially coherent, it has to be certain duration test is there, then disposal test is there. Now you said in this example of MIP. Now MIP was treated as a place of business. Since this place of business was fixed, it may not be fixed on the ground, but it was actually fixed. So we said, okay, the coherence test is also met. Since that MIP was there with the issuer bank as well as with the acquirer bank for the entire year, the permanence test was also satisfied. Would you like to throw some light as to how the disposal test was satisfied?
Yes. It is important that if we have to create PE of a non-resident enterprise, it should have a disposal, that MIP must be at his disposal. So the question is, what happened in this particular case? The MIP were earlier owned by a non-resident entity, which was associated enterprise of the Singapore entity. Then In December 2014, restructuring happened and the ownership of the MIP was transferred to the Indian subsidiary. What revenue contended that ownership was only transferred on paper because no VAT or no sale tax was paid, number one. Number two, the Indian entity has never entered into any agreement with the banks in whose premises this MIP are placed. So we relied on, revenue relied on these two particular aspects. But then revenue also made it clear that ownership is not important for the permanent, for the PE test. It would be important when we talk about royalty, not at this stage. So AAR also said that yes, at this stage, it is not important to see whether MIPs are owned by the applicant or MIPs are owned by MISPL. What we need to see is whether it is at the disposal. So that aspect about ownership will come when we discuss royalty. On this issue disposal, what happened? There is no agreement of MISPL with the Indian banks where the MIPs are placed. MIPs have to be maintained. There is a software inside MIPs. And the transfer pricing report of MISPL says that that software is owned by the applicant outside India. Because it doesn't say software directly, it says all the intangibles are owned by the applicant, Singapore entity. And software is an intangible. So basically, it was an admitted fact that software inside MIPS continues to be owned by the Singapore entity. Who maintains the software? Because software has to be regularly upgraded. As you understand, that this is like a technological, there is a technology involved, so software has to be regularly upgraded. It is admitted by the applicant that this software is updated from outside India by foreign entities. The contract with those entities, third party service provider, are entered by the AEs of Singapore entity outside India. Because it was done before 1/4/2014, the same entities continues to carry on this maintenance activity, continues to enter into agreement about this maintenance activity. Once again, we found out that who are the people who are responsible for MIP here in the Indian subsidiary MISPL. There were certain names which were given, and we demonstrated that those people did not have technical capability to maintain the MIP. So this was admitted, and they said that it is not required that, you know, that if I am the owner of MIP, I must have the technical capability to maintain the MIP. And the example of an electronic equipment was given. I might own a TV, I might own an AC, doesn't mean that I need to have technical capability to maintain that perfectly. So what revenue argued that that's all right, but if I am the owner of an electronic instrument, I will take the decision, I will decide whether who should maintain this, at what cost it should be maintained, if it has to be upgraded, whether it has to be upgraded or not, if it has to be changed, you know, it has outlived its life, whether it has to be changed, whether it should be, who should, I will take the decision, I will not allow somebody else to take the decision. And when I give my electronic instrument to somebody else, whether to repair or for anything else, then I will have some agreement with him, some invoices with him, whatever, you know. So it won't happen that MIPs are lying in the place of Indian banks here in India, and the agreement is with the applicant, with the Singapore entity, not with the MISPL. MISPL does not have any capability to take the decision, and there we relied on the OECD recent transfer pricing updation that which talks about delineation of transaction, that who controls the risk, who takes the risk, who has the technical capability to take the risk, and who has the financial capacity to take the risk. So it was demonstrated that MISPL does not control the risk. The risk is controlled by the Singapore entity outside India, and then it was shown, you know, whatever the maintenance cost which is being incurred by the third party, it comes to the Indian entity. Indian entity MISPL puts 12% on it and then charges back to the applicant. So there is no value addition by the Indian entity. So this also proves that ultimately financial capacity is with the applicant, Singapore applicant. The technical capability is with the associated enterprise outside India who does it on behalf of the Singapore entity. And so basically it was demonstrated that MIPs are at the disposal of the Singapore entity. Then there was one more additional point which was not presented by the revenue, but it was quoted by AAR. Probably, I think there was some after hearing happened. Probably we both were allowed to file some additional submission. So I think in that submission, the applicant must have filed some information, and AAR relied on that information that when MIFs are placed in the premises of the Indian banks, they have to pay certain charges to the Singapore entity, not to the MISPL. So this was also a very important fact noted by AAR, and on the basis of all these facts, it was decided that MIFs are at the disposal of the Singapore entity.
So three points, in fact two points. The first, when there is a transaction or there is any reorganization, it should not only be on paper, it should be actually taken place. And the compliance or sanctity of the transaction will not be looked only from the income tax perspective, it has to be vetted from other laws. Like you gave the example of VAT, wherein even though the ownership was transferred on paper, no VAT was paid. First. The second thing which you
said. That is what AAR has noted, and even till today it has not been paid.
Okay.
So, transaction happened in December 2014.
Okay. So that was a deliberate and that...
No, I won't say deliberate, we are not here on deliberate part.
What I meant was, that was a fact which also made the AAR to deliberate, okay, this
Okay.
Not that deliberate.
Not that deliberate. Yeah, so let me clarify, because revenue had also made a plea that it is, that everything is a colorable device, but that plea was rejected. So, If you are going as per this judgment which has been ruling which has been given by AAR, then what they did had a commercial reason, has a business reason, but if we delineate the transaction, we will find that it creates permanent establishment.
The second point which you said was that the instructions. So assuming that the ownership was transferred to the Indian entity, actually the VAT was also paid. But still, in those cases also, if the applicant, that is a Singapore entity, was responsible for everything, for maintenance,
yes,
or they were in a control over that, then that would have also satisfied the disposal.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely.
So in addition to MIPS, now we understand that MIP was referred, MIP was concluded as that it is creating a permanent establishment of Singapore entity. Another issue which came up was, whether the network, the MasterCard network, will also going to create a permanent establishment or not. What is your take on this?
Yeah, so basically revenue made this plea that we need to go beyond MIFs also, because if we restrict ourselves to MIF, then attribution will be restricted to only authorization part of the transaction processing. But we need to see whether the other part of MasterCard network, that is transmission towers, internet, nodes, application software. In fact, in this case, there are application software also, MasterCard Connect and File Express, which are given to the banks, and on this there is no dispute that they are owned by the Singapore entity. So these application software, because when we spoke about that clearance and settlement, remember? So it is through this application software the information is exchanged by the banks with the applicant. So idea is whether now all this together, MasterCard network, whether that create permanent establishment or not. Taxpayers said that it does not, because no part of MasterCard network is in India. It's all outside India, like server and other things. Revenue claim that it is admitted by the applicant itself in his transfer pricing report that MasterCard network consists of all these items, and these part of these items are in India. We know that MIFs are in India. We know that transmission lines are in India, in Singapore also, but in India also. Similarly, internet also at both the places. Application software is in India. So we said that a part of the MasterCard network is in India. Now we have to apply the test of permanency and disposal and function also to this MasterCard network. So what revenue claimed that when we come to settlement, what is first clearance. Clearance is the position about settlement, what is the final position of each bank at the end of the day. That is clearance. So for that we relied on the application statement itself, that is what clearance is. And we said that position is known to each bank For example, if SBI has issued 100 cards which were used by the customers, SBI knows what transactions have happened in those 100 cards. And SBI at the end of the day does its own part of the calculation. That okay, this is my final position. As an issuer bank, this is the amount I have to pay. As an acquirer bank, this is the amount I have to get. And SBI knows at the end of the day that this is the final amount which has to be either debited to my account or credited to my account. So, yes, but Bank of India, this will not help Bank of India, because Bank of India has to ultimately pass the net entry. Obviously, 100 banks in India won't inform Bank of India that you pass with this entry, you pass with that entry. That instruction has to come from the Singapore entity, because Bank of India is acting on behalf of Singapore entity. And therefore, all these information goes to Singapore, and there is an MCI entity which does collating of information on behalf of the Singapore entity, that what is the final position of each bank. The taxpayer says that that final position is determined outside India, which is fine, we are not disputing that. But that final position is already known to the banks here in India. And that has been generated in India through the MasterCard network, which is in India. And therefore, the revenue claim that clearance part of activity is happening in India. And so far as settlement is concerned, the applicant himself admitted that settlement is the transfer of fund between from issuer bank to acquirer bank. So revenue said fine, this is settlement, and it happens only when Bank of India passes that debit and credit entry. So the revenue submission was that settlement is actually happening in India when Bank of India passes that entry. So this was a submission of revenue, that clearance and settlements are happening in India through MasterCard network. So that means the functions are happening in India. There is a permanency involved, no dispute about that permanency. And then they are at the disposal, because it was admitted by the applicant itself that it maintains MasterCard network from outside India, number one. Number two, the counsel of the applicant during hearing, which has been noted in the AAR order, also stated that the applicant, the Singapore entity, secures that MasterCard network so that there is less chances of fraud, so that the transaction is secured. So that means if the Singapore entity is securing the network, it is controlling that network, that means it is at its disposal. And we relied upon the Amadeus and Galileo case, and it is very well explained by AAR how the facts of Amadeus and Galileo case are similar to the facts of this case. And there also, the similar kind of a network created a P in those two cases also. And there is no dispute, as of now, there is no dispute in those two cases about the existence of P. The only dispute which is pending in Supreme Court is about attribution of profit. So far as existence of P is concerned, that has attained finality in both Galileo and Amadeus. So this was the plea of the revenue which was accepted by AAR.
So, yeah. Sir, like you said, that network infrastructure is also going to constitute a PE. Do you foresee that there is a challenge for all those companies who are in undersea cables or similar kind of infrastructure and doing business with India?
See, undersea cable, though, I don't think there should be any dispute that it creates a permanent establishment, because there is an Australia case which is also there in your book, and Revenue had quoted that in before AAR, okay. That undersea cable can create a permanent establishment. And so far as other things like Amadeus and Galileo are a prime example. I just quoted those two cases. What happened in Amadeus and Galileo was that CRS, Computer Reservation System, was a software. Part of that software was installed on the computer of the travel agents in India. So I, as a customer, if I go to those travel agent, I give my choice that I have to travel to Russia for World Cup football. What are the best airlines available? What are the best hotels available? And this is my limitation, price limitation. That information from the computer of the travel agent goes to the final server outside India. The actual processing happens outside India. The data, all that data is stored in the server outside India, and the processing happens outside India. And through that processing, they determine that, okay, this is the best route for Kamlesh Varshney on these dates at this time for these hotels and everything, and that information is sent to the travel agent computer, and then from that travel agent computer, travel agent tells me that these are the best alternatives available to you, or these are the various options available to you. So now AAR says that our case is stronger than Amadeus and Galileo, because in Amadeus and Galileo, what is done by CRS is only it is sending my request and then getting the final answer. But here that part is already done by application software, because application software is a way of communication between the banks in India and the Singapore entity, and also the transmission network that I spoke about. What AAR said that MIFs are doing something additional to what was happening in Amadeus and Galileo case, because MIFs are also doing preliminary authorization. So this is very important. And then one more important thing which I missed out, that AAR relied on class Google commentary which was quoted by Revenue, that what is preparatory and auxiliary? You know, transmission may be a preparatory and auxiliary if I am doing transmission work for my enterprise. If I am a, let's say, liaison office here in India, and I am doing transmission work for my parent entity outside, non-resident, that may be a preparatory and auxiliary. But if this is the main work of my main parent activity, you know, so that is not preparatory and auxiliary. If my main entity, parent entity, is doing this transmission work for the third party and I am doing a part of it, then this is not preparatory and auxiliary. This is what Klaus Vogel says, and he takes the example of R&D activity and other activities. That if R&D activity is performed for the own enterprise, then it is preparatory and auxiliary. But if R&D activity is performed for the third party, then it is not preparatory and auxiliary. So similarly, we relied upon this class Vogel, which was accepted by AAR, and AAR said that yes, this is a transmission activity, because ultimately MasterCard is also doing the same. You know, it is also doing that transmission and all those activity, and part of that is performed by the network here in India. So that is not, that cannot be called preparatory and auxiliary.
So one, you know, comment I would like to add here, you know, for the professionals and students who are practicing international tax, I think now the department has started going deep into the facts. So
yes.
You also, you know, when giving the opinion, ensure that you have all the facts before you are concluding whether something will create PE or not.
Yeah.
Ashish, you are having some questions.
Sir, a lot of stress was given on the software, application software, that played a very important role and that helped in communication between Indian banks and the Singapore entity. Do you think this case being cited in future to argue that even software can be a place of business? I think that the position which...
But that happens in Amadeus and Galileo.
But there actually the only difference which I think was that software was installed in a system.
Yeah.
If there can be something which online, if I'm accessing, like online portals or something, and if that helps in communicating this kind of information, whether in future you see that can also be
clear? Yeah, so that issue also came up here, but what AAR observed, that we are not seeing, so there is no clear-cut finding by AAR on this issue.
Okay.
What AAR said, that we are not seeing software alone, we are seeing together, you know, everything together.
Okay.
So they have seen MIP as standalone, yes, MIP creates E. Then they have seen the MasterCard network, which also include MIP again here, but MIP, transmission tower, nodes, cable, internet, application software together, whether together they do significant activities, and whether together they pass the test of P.
Okay. If software start creating P, then it will, you know, have a lot of issues. Now,
that's a position I think India has taken.
Let's see.
But there is no finding by AAR on software standalone. There is no funding.
Even in MIP, you know, MIP was also a hardware with the software.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, which was the fact in case of Amadeus also. There was a hardware and a software. Sir, we do not have much time, but so we will do quickly everything.
Yeah, sure.
Now, the Bank of India, you know, which you referred initially. So, I think somewhere AAR also talked about that Bank of India will going to become a permanent establishment of, Singapore entity. But employees of Bank of India, they said it will not create a service PE. Can you give, you know, some clarity on that part? You know, Bank of India, they said, would be a PE.
Yeah.
They said Bank of India would be the agent and accordingly become a...
Yeah, so what AAR has observed, of course, our plea was that both Bank of India is a fixed place PE and the employees of Bank of India do create service PE. So the facts here are that Bank of India has a dedicated team which carries out the settlement activity, and they don't take instruction from Bank of India management. They take instruction from the applicant. So applicant tells them that, okay, pass A, Bank A so much debit, Bank B so much credit, like that. And they do that. And if there is any error, and this was submitted by both revenue as well as the applicant, no dispute on this fact. If there is any error, it is responsibility is on the Singapore entity. Responsibility is not on Bank of India. Now, based on these facts, AAR observed that it is not a principal-to-principal transaction. The employees of the Bank of India have a space to occupy in Bank of India. They are dedicated team, so they do work for Singapore entity, and therefore they create a permanent establishment. Applicant had also raised a view that how can it create a PE, because the employees of Singapore entity cannot walk into Bank of India. So it was explained by AAR that we are not creating PE for that reason. We are creating PE because there is a space available within Bank of India which need not to be exclusive space, because OECD commentary also says that for creating PE you need not have exclusive disposal. So there is a place in Bank of India which is at the disposal of the Singapore entity, is also at the disposal of Bank of India, no doubt, but it is at the disposal of Singapore entity because they are dedicated employees who have a right to occupy that space, and they take instruction from the Singapore entity. But when it came to PE, because the service PE article uses about employees and other personnel, the AAR says that they are working for Bank of India, but they are not working for the applicant. I think probably we will examine this aspect, whether revenue would like to appeal on that aspect or not. We haven't examined it right now.
Ashish, you have some question?
Okay.
Now I am on my last question as far as judgment is concerned, and then we have one question from the audience also that we will take up. It was also argued that it will going to constitute FTS or royalty, wherein the MasterCard was saying no, it is the payment for a transactional service and not for the use of brand name or intangibles. Whereas department argued no, it is for the use of intangibles, trademark and everything. So what AAR said, AAR agreed with you or?
Yeah, of course, because Formula 1 case law was applied, although in Formula 1 revenue lost. Because in Formula 1, there was a artwork license agreement, and then there was the main agreement for the carrying out of the business. So in that case, Delhi High Court had observed that licensing of brand was incidental to the actual conduct of business. And this was not appealed by revenue in Supreme Court, so that attained finality. So, but there are certain tests which were laid down by Delhi High Court in Formula 1, that on what basis they decided that it is incidental. I think the first point which was important was Note 10.1 of 2010 OECD commentary, when they say that the licensing of brand for distribution of goods and services. Absolutely. But in this case, there is no distribution of goods and services, because what Singapore entity is doing, transaction processing. And Indian banks are recipient of that services. It is not that Indian banks have to distribute some goods or services of Singapore entity and for that they need the brand name of MasterCard. No, the MasterCard was doing transaction processing activity, and for that they don't need their own brand name. The brand name was licensed to the Indian banks for their cards. It was, the agreements were produced to demonstrate that licensing of brand by the MasterCard to the Indian bank was for their card programs. This card does not belong to MasterCard, this card belongs to SBI. So this was a very important aspect. And it was also demonstrated that actually the Singapore entity is also paying royalty to US entity. Because ultimately this MasterCard is not owned by Singapore entity. Singapore entity has taken it on license from US entity. So Singapore entity is paying royalty to US entity for licensing of these brands and use of these brands in India. So now AAR observed, now if this is the situation, that if you are taking if you are paying royalty to your US company for use of intangibles in India, the money that you are receiving from banks to whom you have further licensed these intangibles also represent royalty.
No, but then I have a question. Let's say, you know, we have entity in Singapore which is into manufacturing, correct?
Yeah.
Now that entity takes some intangible on license from US. Now, from Singapore, what we are purchasing is a good.
Yes.
We should have a payment for both intangible and, you know, that material. But we'll never be able to break it into payment for intangible and payment for good.
That's perfectly fine.
So the amount which we paid, you know, the amount in this case, you know, which was going, was not only for the intangible, but for also for a lot many other things. For the transaction cost, you know, the processing which was happening. So why it was, you know, segregated in this case?
No. Let us first understand, you took an example that Singapore entity is into manufacturing and it has taken on license certain brands, okay. And then it integrates that brand into that manufactured item, and then it has a distributor here in India. The distributor pays for the manufactured items along with the brand, which is
a consolidated
price. But I already covered that note 10.1 of OECD commentary says that I am your distributor, I am distributing your goods, and brand is only incidental to the purchase of the goods, import of the goods from Singapore. But in this case, banks are not doing transaction processing services. Mm-hmm. Banks are receiving transaction processing services. Banks are selling their own cards. These are not MasterCard, and on them they are using this MasterCard logo.
Oh, correct.
So that is the basic difference.
So is it that you are trying to say that in respect of services, the characterization of a transaction has to be same? Generally, like in the incident case, you said that when USA company is licensing it, they are taking a royalty from Singapore entity or even the Indian entity. But when Singapore entity was taking money from banks, they were showing it only as a transaction processing.
So what AAR says that it's okay. In fact, revenue has obtained information from banks and they said that we are paying for transaction processing, we are not paying royalty. But AAR said that is not how we are going to decide. We have to decide the case not by how the banks and Singapore entity are giving a name. We have to decide based on the actual transaction, actual conduct. And that is how they went into all these arguments which I just spoke about. And then they said, yes, that this is wrong. The part payment, not the full payment, a part payment is also for the royalty.
So can you quickly tell us about the service P and dependent names P also in some 2-3 minutes, because that was also
See, service P, Bank of India, I have already covered, which was not held to be service P.
Yes.
But the employees of the MasterCard Singapore entity are coming to India to render services. So this was our plea, and 90 days threshold is crossed in the treaty. So therefore it creates service P. Now, the objection of the taxpayer was that yes, they do come here for more than 90 days in a year, but it is not for rendering services. They do some kind of a work, like they inform about something new that we are doing, and to take the feedback whether this transaction processing is working properly or not, whether there is anything quality improvement we need to do. So all these activities, for that they interact with the banks, and for that purpose they come here. And they said actual transaction processing is a computerized activity. You don't need a human being to do that activity. So here the revenue had given that ATM example, and AAR relied upon that example that, you know, ATM is an automatic teller machine, is an automatic equipment whose job is to give the cash. But there are a lot of human activities which goes behind it. So it is not that, you know, if there is a mechanical computer, then ATM, you still have a guard who would be there, you still have somebody who will come and put the money there, next day somebody come and reconcile the money there. So you will have human intervention. And if there is any service rendered by the ATM, suppose ATM is rendering any service to me by giving me cash, then you can't say that human beings who are also facilitating that services are not rendering services. They are also rendering such services. Similarly, in this case also, maybe the server, they are automatic equipment, but there are employees associated who are also helping carrying out this business. So it was held that it is, and then MasterCard, that it is steward activity, is a very good distinction which we need to understand. See, in the case of Morgan Stanley, outsource its activity to Indian company. and to check whether Indian company is doing the work properly or not, whether there is quality control or not, those employees used to come and check. That was called a stewardship activity. So that means service was actually rendered by the Indian entity to US entity, and US entity employees came and checked that service. So therefore it was had stewardship activity. Here it is reverse. Here the Singapore entity is rendering service to Indian entity, and then the employees of Singapore are coming and rendering a part of that service. So it is not a stewardship activity like what in Morgan Stanley.
Correct. So the dependent ACP also will be wrapped into it.
Yeah, dependent agent probably, you know, I think that portion is correct. I can also say that probably concluding contract was very difficult to establish. But securing contract is very important part. Securing orders, not contract. Securing orders. So what happens is, and AAR went by the actual statement given by the applicant, said what do they do, how new agreements are entered with the banks, because most of the agreements are old which are continuing, but there are 9 banks with whom they entered new agreements. So the question is how, what was the process followed. So that process was given to AAR, and in that process AAR said that this does not amount to concluding of contract, this amounts to securing of order, because all the orders are placed to MISPL. So and habitual, because the applicant said that there are only 9 contracts in 4 years. How can you call it habitual? So there the AAR relied on OECD commentary that habitual is to be interpreted in the context of the actual work. If I am doing trading activity and there are 1,000 transactions, then 9 will not be habitual. But if there are only 9 transactions in 4 years and all 9 satisfy that test, then it is habitual.
So now we are going on a few questions that we got. So first question is from Pratik Vora, and it's basically 3 questions he has asked. First question, as MasterCard is operating in India for many years, why they are filing application now?
No, yeah, so earlier MasterCard was paying taxes in India. If you read the order, it is written there that by They restructure in December 2014.
Yes.
Revenue said that this is colorable device, but it was not held to be colorable device. But yes, it was accepted that by doing this restructuring, they are paying less taxes to the extent of about 100 crore every year less.
Okay.
You know, by doing this restructuring. And that is why the claim of the revenue was that MISPL is shown to be doing only support services. If MISPL was shown to be doing actual transaction processing activity, then the revenue would not have had that much objection.
So they were having NO which got converted into
MISPL. I mean, MISPL was already there, but all the work of LO was taken over by MISPL.
Another question he asked is, would this judgment affect past year taxability? I think not, because
No, they themselves paid taxes in past years. Full taxes.
And his last question is further, whether it would affect other companies like Visa, etc.
I can't comment on that. I don't know the facts of Visa.
Now, there is another question asked by our viewer Amit Raj Arora. His question is, what if the transaction of MasterCard was taken up like the way in case of Rupee? As ultimately the whole transaction is done for authorizing the transaction securely, which in the present scenario happens through a standalone software that is web. But if it was happened at the server end, after such card details are transferred to this server? A very long question.
Yeah, so no, I've understood. So what he's trying to say is that if suppose they were not using Mint, let's say MasterCard was not using Mint. In fact, this is the advertisement. If you actually see the technical advertisement of MasterCard and Visa, they say that because we use MIP and whatever, I don't know what is the acronym in Visa, that because of that our transaction is more secured and faster. This is what the advertisement is, and that is where RuPay can't compete with us. This is their main advertisement strategy. That is what I have understood. But I may be wrong, of course, but this is what I have understood. So if MIP is not there, placed in the premises of Indian banks, then that other part, you know, so MIP as a PE will not arise, but there are other PEs also. So we need to look at those PEs.
Yeah, in fact, this case was a classic where almost every type of PE was held during the favor of the department, be it fixed place PE or service PE or agency PE, almost every type of PE.
Yeah, even in fixed place, we have network as a PE, you know, so Bank of India as a PE. So, of course, when MIP is not there, it won't be PE.
Correct. So I think this whole discussion was very useful for everyone. Thanks Kamlesh sir for sparing your time. Thanks Ashish for joining us. Trust me, we're going to request her to come again and do these kind of deliberation more with us so that everyone can get benefit through the use of technology.
Thank you. Trying to say that again there would be a case which will not by revenue call them.
Thank you, sir. Thanks everyone for joining us. Thank you. Bye.